Okay, so let's continue looking at trinomials that have non-trivial leading coefficients. Non-trivial meaning more than one, or actually it could even be less than one, could be negative, but just not one. So leading coefficients that are not one. So what we're talking about is factoring a trinomial that's in the form ax squared plus bx plus c, where a is not equal to one. That's why it's not. That's why it's non-trivial, right? Before, when a was 1, we could just go, oh, x times x gives us x squared. So this is a different method. Last time we were talking about the guess and check method. This time we're going to be doing the AC method, okay? So here's how the AC method works. We're going to find a pair of numbers whose product is AC. See, in the past, if you had something like this, x squared plus 5x plus 6, right? If you did, a is here is 1. 1 times 6 is 6, right? So when we were factoring 6, we were really factoring 1 times 6, which meant that that 1 was trivial because 1 times anything is just itself, right? So before, we were factoring just the 6. Now we're going to be factoring the a times the c. So what we're going to, I'll show you in a minute when we get to this example. You see here how a is equal to 4, b is equal to 11, and c is equal to 6. Okay? So instead of a being 1 and we just factor 6, we're going to be multiplying a times c and then factoring to find a number that would multiply to a c but add to b, which is 11. Okay, if such a pair exists, expand the trinomial into 4 terms. Write the term bx as the sum and the difference of the two numbers, and then factor by grouping. So let's go down here just and go ahead and explore the AC method. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to need to find a pair of numbers who has a product of AC, so that's 24. Does everybody see how I'm getting 24? That's 4 times 6. That's AC. Whose sum is still 11. B equals 11. So we're still finding that sum. What do we know about the signs of the numbers? So look at the signs, and let's talk about that for a minute. What are the signs going to have to be? In order to get a positive 24 and a positive 11, tell me about the signs. Yes, they are going to both be positive. Positive, positive gives us a positive, positive. Okay, so now we're going to create a table for the factor pairs of 24. So we're looking now for factors of 24. Okay, so, and then we're going to eventually want a sum of 11. Factors of 24, can you give me any? 1 times 24. Okay, any others? 2 times 12. 3 times 8. Good. 4 times 6. And that's it. Okay, now let's add them together. We get 25, 14. We're getting closer. 3 plus 8 is 11. And if it had been 10, then this would have been our pair. So this is the pair we want. 3 and 8 multiply to 24, and 3 plus 8 add to 11. Okay, so that's our table right there of the factors. Which two numbers have the needed sum? 8 and 3. Or you could say 3 and 8, right? Same thing. Rewrite this as 4 terms. So what that means is we're going to actually split the middle. So we're going to write this as 4x squared plus 8x plus 3x plus 6. So all we did is split the 11 into those two numbers. Aren't these still equivalent expressions? Okay, all I did was split the middle. Now that we have the middle split, the 11x into, we're not just splitting it into 1 and 10 or, you know, any, we're not just splitting it willy-nilly, you know, we're splitting it into the factor pairs, the two numbers, okay? Now, who remembers what we do for factor by grouping? How do we do factor by grouping? you group them. Group the first two, group the last two. And by the way, it wouldn't matter what order I put the middle. I could have put it as 3x here and 8x here. Sometimes people, they like to couple them up because, you know, like when you have friends and you think they're a little bit both single and you're like, you're going to partner them. You want to think about people that have something in common, right? So I think that 8x has more in common with 4x squared. So I'm going to partner them up. I think that 3x goes really well. I think they would be a good couple. So I'm partnering them up. Okay. So now I'm going to look for the greatest common factor of only two at a time. So these are partners. And what is the greatest common factor that can come out of that relationship? 4x. So we factor out the GCF of the first two pair, and we get what would be left behind if you divide these both by 4x? 2x plus, no, actually, sorry, x plus 2. I overheard people's words were colliding with each other. So x plus 2, does everybody see? That's a 1. That's supposed to be a 1 coefficient right there. Let's change it to a 1, okay? What is going to come out of these two? What's the greatest common factor here? Yeah, and we'll put the plus, bring the plus down, 3, and that would be x plus 2. Now remember with factor by grouping, these have got to be a perfect match. If they're a perfect match, you've done it correctly. So now we're going to factor out that binomial. What does that look like? If I factor out x plus 2, what gets left? 4x plus 3. How could I check and make sure that that is the correct answer? FOIL it, okay? Do you remember how to FOIL? Should I show you? Let's just FOIL. Yes. How did I do that? Because these are a match, right? It was like, remember before when we had this situation? What do they have in common? So A would factor out. Right? Now A is actually this x plus 2. So the x plus 2 is getting factored out, and what's left behind is the 4x plus 3. So this is the thing they have in common that's getting factored out, and then 4x plus 3 is left. Does that make sense? Yes? Yes, last step. Okay, that's a really good point. Let's try it. Even though you know, sometimes you match up friends and they don't seem like they would get along, but they're gonna all get along. They're all gonna play together, okay? So let's try that. His question is, what if we change these factors? 4x squared plus 3x plus 8x plus 6, okay? Will it still work? Let's find out. Are you ready? Okay, we're still going to partner these up. They still have something in common. They can still, you know, opposites attract. You don't know. They might work it out. Okay, what do they have in common? X. X is coming out. 4x plus 3, correct? What's coming out of these two? Okay, 4x plus 3 if I divide both of these by 2. So now the greatest common factor, yes, is 4x plus 3 times, this is what's left behind, x plus 2. You see this? This was the common binomial that gets factored out. And, you know, it could be in front. It doesn't have to go in front. Remember that this is the same thing as x plus 2 times 4x plus 3. Remember that, right? Oh, I'm off the page. There we go. Now, if we want to FOIL it, we can always FOIL to check. So when I FOIL, I go x times 4x, that's 4x squared. X times 3 is 3x. 4x times 2, or 2 times 4x, is 8x. And last, there's our 6. So was that the same thing that we started with? Well, we could combine our like terms, 4x squared plus 11x plus 6. Was that the same thing? Okay, so this is your answer. Sometimes I get worried. If you tell me that you're going to check, then that's great. But if you give me this as your answer, not so much like the check, then I'm confused as to know. I don't know if you know that which one is the right answer. Do you know what I'm saying? So if you want to check, that's fine. You can always check. I love it when you check. Okay? Remember, I told you I want you to be OCD about your math. Don't leave the oven on. What does that mean? It means check it, check it, check it. Okay? Don't forget to leave your house and not lock your door. How do you make sure you don't do that? Check it, check it, check it again. Okay? So check. That's my point. All right, let's go on to the next page and let's look at another one. Okay? Let's do this one more time together. At least one more time. Should we do it like two more times? Okay, let's do it again together. So the thing to know, and actually this is going to be important for later, is how to identify the coefficients a, b, and c. So just looking, and remember you have to be careful of the signs. So the first thing we would actually ask ourselves, whenever we look at a problem, the first thing we want to ask ourselves, well, what is the first thing you always want to ask yourself? Is there a GCF? Bingo. Is there a GCF? Number one rule of factoring. I cannot emphasize this enough. So first, take a look. Do you see any GCF there? Does three go into all of them? No. So it's not a GCF, right? Because it's not a factor of, it doesn't go into 16. It's off by one. Okay, so now let's identify the coefficients. The coefficients are 12, 16, and what is c? Negative 3. Good job retaining the sign. We need to find a pair whose product is AC. So AC is 12 times negative 3 is A times C. And that's going to be negative 36. Maybe if that's your jazzy cell phone, you can turn it off. Oh. Okay. And then what about the sum? The sum should be 16. Sum should be 16. Tell me what you notice about the signs. Two numbers that multiply to a negative that add to a positive. What is that going to be? Tell me about the signs. So they have to be opposite signs. Yes, because in order to get a negative 36, we need a positive times a negative. So the signs are opposite. Okay, create a table to find the factor pair of what? Negative 36, good. So we're going to make our table and we're looking for factors of negative 36. So we have to be really careful about the signs here. So factors of negative 36 are what? Okay, 6 times negative 6. Good. I like how you're starting in the middle. It's a perfect square. Now we can go out from there, right? Because we're going to eventually want to have a sum of what? 16. So what would these add to? So that didn't work. So let's keep factoring. What are some other numbers that multiply together to give us 36? Negative 2 times 18. Oh, I love how you just went for it, didn't you? Because that's the answer, isn't it? What do these add up to? 16. Okay. So she found it. Once you find it, you don't have to keep finding the factors. If you know what they are right away, that's part of the fun of factoring, in my opinion. In my opinion, part of the fun of factoring is the mental math. And that really comes from the times tables. Like when I look at the number 24, I just see 4 times 6, 2 times 12. If we don't see those factors right away, it just means we need to practice on those. Okay, and now the thing is to be aware is it's not going to be x minus 2, x plus 18, right? Why is that not the answer? Because what do we have to do with the once we get the pair, we have the pair negative 2 and 18. Why don't I just plug them into those locations like I did last time? It's because of the 12y squared, right? If I were to, actually, these are y, so that didn't help. But even with a y, it still wouldn't work because your last would be negative 36. So what we have to do is we have to rewrite this with the pair splitting the middle. So we're going to write 12y squared, and at the end, we're going to write negative 3. Now, you guys were talking last time about which order. It does not matter, as I proved, it does not matter what order to put them in, but sometimes you have a preference. Sometimes you're like, well, I think the 2 goes really well with the 12, and I think the 18 should be partnered up with the 3. Perfect. Whatever you want to do. So I'm going to do that. Negative 2y plus 18y. You see that those two numbers add to the 16y that's in the middle. So that's why these are actually equivalent. All I've done is split the middle, split the oy term, right? The middle term. I've split it into 2 so that I could strategically factor, I'm writing it again, even though it says factor by grouping, That's why we have these guided notes so we don't have to write so much stuff down. Okay, so we've partnered them up. Do you see how we've split that? And now we've partnered them. Now what are we going to do? What do we want to do once we've partnered them up into 2 groups? Factor it. Yeah, factor it. So what is the greatest common factor that goes into both of these? 2y, and you only want to factor out a negative when the first number is negative. Okay, and then here you would get 6y minus 1. Very good, very good. You see why we need that 1 there, right? Okay, now what about here? What's the greatest common factor of those two? Plus 3, and now we're going to get 6y minus 1. By the way, it has to match. If you look at these and they do not match, start over. Just scrap the whole thing. Something happened, okay? They have to be a match. Or go back. Maybe you didn't divide right or something. Okay, now what is the final factoring? Because this is not done. So we want to factor out the greatest binomial. Basically, 6y minus 1 is the new GCF because it's happening in both, right? So we factor out 6y minus 1. There's the common factor gets factored out. Here's what's left. 2y plus 3. And of course, you can always FOIL to check. Okay. You want to make sure you don't leave the stove on when you leave the house. So check it. And if you're not sure, check it again. Because here... Okay, let's stop the tape really fast.